It's my great pleasure to welcome Tobias here. He's from Kenya, Africa, and I'm very grateful for his flexibility because we were supposed to have him here speaking last Sunday, but then we didn't meet because of the illness, the canceled service. So we were so relieved when we found out that he could come this week. So Tobias, I should say, would you like to come on up?
Sure.
And I'm just going to introduce Tobias, and he is part of the leadership of an amazing ministry called Disciples of Mercy, is that right, in Kenya? Yes? Mm-hmm. And he's been telling us today a little bit about what, earlier today, a little bit about what they've been doing. They do a lot of work with children, schooling, as well as with prison ministry and that sort of thing. And he's been involved in that for many years now. And so we're very grateful to have him here to speak to us on what the Lord has put on his heart for today. And I just want to begin by anointing him and just praying for him before he begins. Lord, I just give you thanks and praise for Brother Tobias. Thank you for bringing him here today. I thank you, Lord, that this is a time, Lord, that you have established. This is an appointment that you have made, Lord, for Tobias to be with us today, Lord. I just anoint him right now in the name of Jesus Christ. I thank you, Lord, for the anointing that's on his life, Lord, to have a heart on fire for you and for your purposes in this world, to have a heart on fire for your word, Lord, and to share that word, Lord Jesus. But I just ask, Lord, right now for a greater anointing, just to fall upon him, Lord Jesus. From heaven above, Lord, fill him, Lord. Fill him, Lord. Fill him right now as we pray, Lord. I thank you, Lord Jesus. Give him, Lord, words from the throne room of heaven. Words prepared, Lord, for this point in time, for this season, for this day, Lord. Words prepared for your sheep. Bless you. Give him words to speak to your sheep today, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Bless you, brother.
Amen. Praise the Lord. How's everybody going? Good. I want to say what a blessing it is to be here. Again, thank you for entrusting me with an opportunity like this. This is great trust. And I want to believe God does not do things purposelessly. God is a God of purpose, and divine connections are for a purpose. And I want to believe our presence here and our being here today is divinely orchestrated. And just the few minutes of being here, I'm amazed at how multinational we are raised up here. I feel like I'm among the nations. And that is a good thing because that's the kingdom.
Yes.
So when we get to heaven, there'll be no particular corner for Kenyans and another corner for the Scottish and the Norwegians will be taking their happy corner somewhere. We will all be one happy family.
Amen.
The earlier we start that down here, the better.
Yeah.
And sometimes we get hung up on all these differences and we lose the big picture of what the kingdom is about.
Amen.
The kingdom is about the blood of Jesus making us one family for his purposes while we are still here on the earth. And so it is a joy to be here. Lots of greetings from my wife and my family. I so appreciate the connections that we have here with Northern Ireland. For several years, we've had connections with several people here. Through divine connections, we got to know Ellen. Can't remember, that must be 100 years ago.
I hope not.
And Ellen has become not just a friend of ours, but part of our family. She has a ministry about a couple of hours, maybe 2.5 hours from us to the west of Kenya. We are based in Kisumu. She's based in a place popularly known as Teso, and there she does a great work. And through her, of course, we've come to know Jim and Christine, who've also been out there, and we've met not only here but also on our soils. We've also met Corinne, who's also been out there, and we met on our soils. And maybe the rest of you will also meet on our soils. Who knows? But sure, it's definitely a great pleasure to be here. And my wife is Natalie. Just going to show you maybe just a quick glance around. I've got a beautiful family of one wife and So my wife Natalie, she's slightly over 18. Our daughter, our firstborn, Carolee is 15, and she's in third year of high school. And Leticia is our middle daughter, and Leticia is 13. She's in her final year of primary school. And the last one is called Caitlin. And Caitlin tells me she is 4, and she's big now. So I thought I'd just make sure that you understand that so that you don't call her a little child. was said in the introduction, for the last 25 years, I've been part of a ministry called Disciples of Mercy, based in Kisumu, founded by my mother-in-law. And we've had the privilege of working and serving under that ministry in many, many capacities up to end of last year. 31st of December last year was our farewell as we were released to follow up on other things that God would lead us onto and lay in our hearts. And that's what we are doing. We are therefore in kind of a transition. Mm-hmm. And it's like a boy leaving home. You know, after 25 years in one place, you step out and it's like leaving home to start a new life. Yeah. But it's exciting. Mm-hmm. It's exciting because we know who we have believed in. Amen. It's exciting because we know whom we are following. We know His faithfulness. Mm-hmm. We have proved it. We have walked in it. We have benefited from it. Mm-hmm. And we are witnesses that the good work that it begins in us is faithful to bring to accomplishment. Yes. And therefore, it is a joy to be here. My very first time up here in Northern Ireland. Mm-hmm. And I've enjoyed it. It would have been nice to bring some sun from Kenya, but that is not possible. But it's been fun, and we've had a really, really, really great time. I must admit, I've really enjoyed the time of worship we've had here. It's in many circles, people tell you about the dying church in Europe. And it's good to come to a place where there is a church that is not dying. It's good to come to a place where the Spirit of God is moving.
Amen.
A place where people acknowledge the life that is in the move of the Spirit of God, and not only acknowledge it, but hunger enough after it to go for it.
Yes.
And I believe that's what you guys are doing, and I just want to appreciate that. I want to appreciate your passion. I want to appreciate your hunger and your thirst for the things of God. And wow, great things are ahead.
Amen.
I was just thinking, even when I heard about coming to be part of this fellowship, just the name alone, the upper room, and I was imagining the stuff that happened in the upper room, and I'm thinking, how cool, how wonderful to be part of something like that. And you know, we can expect the thing that we see in the church in the book of Acts, it was seed for this church. And so we can expect multiplications that even out of this upper room, great multitudes can come into the kingdom, and great multitudes can know of the glory of God to be revealed.
Yeah.
Amen. I want to share with you a word in my heart, beginning to read from Genesis chapter 1, if you may please. Over the years, we've had, like I said, the privilege of working in many capacities, ranging from children. I've done a lot of ministry in schools to see the lives of young people being impacted. A lot of ministry in prisons, over 40 prisons across Kenya, ministering and getting people born again, registering them in Bible schools and training them as ministers, and upon release, helping some of them get established in the ministry and reintegrated back into the community. And it's been amazing to see the power of the Word of God working in the lives of people. That is our only chance. That is our only answer. That is our only solution to the issues of life. The truth of the Word of God received, embraced, and acted upon. Genesis chapter 1, the creation story. That's a very basic place to start any message. God decides He's going to make man. And in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, then God said, let us make mankind in our image, you know, after our likeness, and let them have complete authority over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and the tame beasts, and over all the earth, and over everything that creeps upon the earth. Verse 27. So God created man in his own image. In the image and likeness of God, he created him. Male and female, he created him. He created them. And God blessed them and said to them, take note of this if you're following in your Bible. Be fruitful. I'm reading from the Amplified Version. Multiply and fill the earth and subdue it, using all its vast resources in the service of God and man, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and over every living creature that moves upon the earth. The creation story, simple, basic Sunday school story. But in that story, I draw a message that's in my heart that I want to share with you this afternoon. Making a difference in our world. Every one of us, God has called us out for a very specific purpose, to make a difference in our world. So he creates man and he plants man in the garden. But he says when he creates man, the command is, I want you to go out and be fruitful. I've underlined certain words. I want you to go out and be fruitful. So evidently, fruitfulness is part of our mandate. And when we are not being fruitful, we are living short of what God expects us to do. Number two, he says, go out and multiply. Let's make man so that man can multiply. So multiplication is part of our mandate. And that's not only me having my three beautiful daughters, but it's more than that. It's more than that. I better be having some multiplication in the kingdom as well.
Amen.
God has called me to do more multiplication in the kingdom than in anything else that I can do. And I must always be asking myself, over and above everything else that I have multiplied, how much multiplication am I bringing to the kingdom? Number three, he says, I want you to fill the earth. I want you to fill the earth. My scriptural mandate for my ministry is Habakkuk 2:14. And part of what God has called me to do is to cause the knowledge of his glory to fill the earth as the waters cover the sea. And when I read fill the earth, that's what I see. That wherever I go, that the earth, my earth will be filled with the knowledge of his glory. His manifestation, his goodness, his weightiness. Yeah. That people will sense the presence of God wherever I go. Amen. Because I've showed up with that presence. Yes. Yeah. And so God says, I want you to subdue the earth. Mm-hmm. I want you to go out and subdue the earth. Statistics are giving us some very concerning and worrying trends. Who is in charge of the earth today? Is it the believers?
No.
Is it the non-believers? Is it the Muslims? And if we are not, then we need to be asking ourselves, to what degree are we subduing?
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
And then he tells them, I want you to have dominion. Dominion is part of our mandate. So if we are not having dominion, God is getting concerned. The church has been called, planted, established to have dominion.
Amen.
And folks, that's my message to you this afternoon, that when we begin to look at all these things, something has to happen when we show up.
Yes.
And if something is not happening when we show up, then we are living far short of what God intended us to do, and we are not fulfilling the desires, the plans, and purposes of God for our lives.
Amen.
And that ought to concern us as believers.
Yes.
Amen.
It's wonderful to come and have praise and worship. It's wonderful to read my Bible and have my daily devotion. It's wonderful to walk about quoting scripture. But God wants to know, am I subduing the earth? Am I having dominion? Am I multiplying? Am I filling the earth? Am I ruling and reigning on behalf of him so that people look at me and say, look what the Lord has done.
Amen.
God is calling us to make a difference in our generation. And so God takes man and he plants man in the garden. Again, I say, basic creation story. But when he plants man, he does not tell him, go on and enjoy. That was part of it. But notice what he tells him, Genesis chapter 2. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. And the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to tend and to guard and to keep it. He put him there with an assignment. I want you to tend the garden, I want you to guard the garden, and I want you to keep it. Why? Because that assignment was going to make a difference in that garden. When we show up in any sphere of life, there is an assignment upon our life. And when we begin to execute that assignment, God then shows up to make the difference, and people begin to realize we are not here on our own. We are not just here because we existed. We are not just here by chance, but we are here on a divine assignment.
Amen.
Everywhere God plants us, He plants us on a divine assignment. Making a difference is part of having influence. And God has called us to have influence. Where God has planted you at any given time, He's called you to have influence at that place, at that point in time. And so the question today is this: what difference are we making in our families? You know, when we talk about making a difference, all of a sudden people think, maybe I should be in government. And that would be great for you to be in government. But it starts with my family. The fact that I'm a husband. If you want to talk to my wife, what am I making as a difference in that relationship? So that people look at me and say, that relationship is godly, that one is not. That relationship has the presence of God, that one is not. When you talk to my daughters as a father, what do they have as a testimony about me? That is the difference I'm talking about. Because sometimes we become all religious about Christianity and we leave it out there and forget where it starts. It starts in the home. That is real Christianity. That is the unit that God wants to show Himself first. Then we can leave it out. What do your neighbors think? Neighbors. What about our friends? Are we making a difference in their lives? Some of us hold jobs or do businesses. The people you work with in the office. The people we do business with. If we go to school, the people we go to school, go to college with. The fact that we are born again and represent God, what do they see in us? What difference does my showing up at my place of work make in somebody else's life? Or do we have split personalities? Christian, now I'm at work. I'm Christian, now I'm at home. A story is told of a pastor that went out preaching everywhere. And people loved the pastor. Every time pastor was in church, pastor was a great guy. Everybody wanted to be around pastor because he was just an awesome, awesome man of God. But the wife didn't think so. Because when he showed up at home, he was a tyrant. And so one day, pastor goes out on a mission trip to go and preach. When pastor comes home, there is nobody in the house. He walks into the house and the house is empty. No wife, no children, no furniture, no dog, no cat. And he goes to the neighbor and he says, did you see my family? And the neighbor says, yeah, sure. She brought a truck, loaded up the whole family, and we saw the truck driving towards the direction of your church building. And so the pastor races to the church building and he opens the door of the church. And here is the wife, has arranged all the furniture inside the church, and the kids are happily playing inside the church. And he asks the wife, what are you doing? The wife looks at him and says, I wanted to live in a place where you're nice, because you're always nice in church. So I thought I would move home and come and live in church. Split personalities. One day we are Christians and we look like we are really on our way to heaven, and another day we look like we're the devil's cousin. And making a difference must be something we wake up to. And from the time I step out of my bed, I say, thank God, this is the day the Lord has made. I'm going to make a difference in it. This is the day the Lord has made. As I go to work, everyone that crosses my path is going to know I have Jesus. I'm so excited about your passion for this peninsula. It's going to take all of us. It's going to take every one of us making a difference in our world.
Yeah.
Because where all of you go, Sue may never go. The people Jan interacts with, other people may never interact with. But every single one of them needs a difference because of the presence of Christ in our lives.
Amen.
And so it's a question today is, what difference are we making in our society? You know, a place like this where we all come together and worship, even in church. Church is the place where many people are hurt and nobody cares about them. Why? Because you go to many churches and after a while, human beings are habit-forming creatures. We decide where we normally sit, and so every Sunday we go, we sit in that corner. And the few friends that form the same habit, they all sit around there. And so we get in there and give each other a high five and give each other a hug. And then we talk about whatever we want to talk about, and somebody preaches a nice message, and then we go home. But we never really become candid with each other and say, how are you going? How's everything with you? How can I make a difference in somebody's life? And so we live in our little cocoons, and yet people are hurting in the church. People put on a smile in the church, but deep inside, tears are flowing, blood is flowing from heartaches. And church, we must step out to make a difference in people's lives.
Amen.
It's wonderful to go to Africa like my sister Ellen and the difference she's making in a village. If you were to go in the village where she's based, it's amazing the difference she's making there. Not every one of us is going to go to desert. Not every one of us should go there. And I've not come here to invite anybody to Africa. But I've come to invite you to your sphere of influence.
Yeah.
I've come to invite you to make a difference in your family, to make a difference in your neighborhood, to make a difference in your church, to make a difference wherever the Lord plants you. If He plants you on a train to Dublin, make a difference on that train.
Yes.
Why? Because we everywhere we are on assignment. We are a 24-hour, 24/7 group of people on assignment every day. And God is saying, I want that difference. Let me read this statement. Being normal, being ordinary, being average does not make any difference. If you say, I just want to live a normal life, it does not make any difference. People get so comfortable with being normal. God's not called us to be normal. Are you just a normal husband? It's a normal worker? Gets in at 8, gets out at 5. You do 8 to 5 here?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Or 9 to 4, whatever? Mm-hmm. You just being normal. You don't start any fires, you don't put any off. You're just normal. Normal parent. Just a normal congregant. Let's face it. Now, when I look at our faces, every one of us has a lot of experiences in life. And I'm sure there are people you remember in your life. There are people in your family you remember. There are people from your schooling days you remember. There are people from places you have worked that you remember. And for some of us, those are hundreds of people. And you couldn't possibly remember hundreds of people. Which ones do you remember? You remember two categories of people. You remember one, people that made positive difference in your life. And every time you think about school, you remember so-and-so, and you remember so-and-so. And you could have been in a school of 500 people, 200 people, 300 people. You could have been in a class of 20 people. But there are particular people that made a difference. There are particular teachers that made a difference. There are particular neighbors that made a difference. Even in your own family, there are particular aunties or cousins or something that made a difference and made an impact in your life. And then there is Uncle Johnny that was just negative. The people who made the negative impact of your life. And you remember them too. Because you're just thinking, my goodness, that's an example of what not to be. An example of what not to do. They just rub everything else the wrong way. Do we remember those people? Mm-hmm. And the question today is, what do people remember you about? Because just as you remember them, some people also remember you. Maybe there are places you've been and you've worked. What do people think about you? Neighborhoods that we've lived in. When our name comes up in a conversation, what is it that people say? Aha, yes. Some of those may not be worth talking about here today. And we need to think about that. And need to ask ourselves, when we had opportunity, God is so gracious the way he gives us opportunity. God is so amazing that he can go into the dust and pick us up, dust us, clothe us with his glory, and set us on our journey.
Amen.
Amazing opportunity. Every single day we wake up, he says, I give you another opportunity to make a difference. And folks, it's important that we grab them with the honor and the reverence, knowing this is my opportunity from the Lord. This is my divine assignment today. And decide, I'm going to make a difference. I'm going to make a difference in somebody else's life. Or do we just want to be remembered as people who lived and then died? The story of Methuselah is the man who lived the longest in the Bible. True?
Yeah.
You know how many chapters the story of Methuselah covers?
No.
We know he lived until he was 900 and something years, and then he begot Enoch, and then he died. So if you have this reputation that you're the one who's lived the longest in the Bible, and there's only so much about you, and I'm sure Methuselah must have also done his assignment, but surely he deserved more record than that. And that's the question today. How much can be recorded about us? When they lived here, when they worked here, when they were a member of this church, when they were an uncle to us, when that was a father to us, this is the impact they left in our lives. And this is the truth for every one of us. God, in his wisdom, has put in every one of us the resource, the supply of the Spirit that we need to make the difference. Because God would not call us and put us on an assignment and not equip us for it. And that's what we need to begin to ask ourselves. What grace is it that God's put on my life? Because that grace is for a purpose. What talent is it that God has put on me and inside of me? That talent is for a purpose. What motivation do I have? You know, Romans chapter 12 talks about those motivations. Some have a motivation to teach. Others a motivation to lead. Others a motivation to give. Others a motivation to show mercy. Why is that motivation there? What do I have? What skills do I have? Some of us are skilled gardeners. I mean, they touch a flower, and before it touches the soil, it's already blossoming. Why is it like that? Is that so that I can make a difference in somebody's life? Yes. What experiences do we have? The experiences that we've gone through, could your experience make a difference in somebody else's life? Now, sometimes we go through experiences and we think, oh, why did that have to happen to me? Well, it has happened now. Yes. How can we turn that and use it to make a difference in somebody else's life?
Amen.
Instead of waiting for us to be the one that the whole world crumbles upon our shoulders, can we say, thank you, God, that I've passed through this and you are faithful to bring me through this. I now want to turn that test into a testimony and for the glory of God, the devil, what you meant for harm, I'm turning around. No, that's why Micah says this, rejoice not over me, O my enemy, for when I fall, I shall arise. And so when I fall in the dust, I get up and say, ooh, that was nasty, that's myself, and I set myself on my journey again. Why? Because every experience, every talent, every gifting is an equipment for my next season, for my next level, for my next assignment to make a difference. Wow. Wow. Some of us can cook. I'm also a very good cook. I know how to make cups of tea, and that's where it starts. Yeah.
But I should be asking myself, you make very good cups of tea. How can I use my cup of tea to make a difference in somebody else's life? Next time you visit, I'll make you a cup of tea. And then my wife will take over. She's a superb cook. So together we form a great team. She knows how to cook and I know how to eat. Matthew 25 is a famous parable of the talents. Master is going away, and he calls his servants and he gives them talents. It's a long reading. We don't have time to read, but the story I'm referring to is from verse 14 through to verse 46. When he calls them, the Bible says, according to each one's ability, he gives them talents. To one he gives five, to another he gives two, and to another he gives one. And then he takes his journey. When he comes back, he calls them to settle accounts with them. He calls them to do what? There's a day of reckoning. There's a day of settling accounts. There's a day when we have to give some answers. And like somebody said, you have two options. You can hear him say, well done. Or you can hear him say, well done. Do we want to hear him just say, well? Or do we want to hear him say, well done?
Amen.
It all depends on what you do. That which he bestowed upon you.
Yes.
So one guy comes up and he's excited. He says, you gave me five, and I brought five back. Another guy comes and he says, you gave me two, and I've earned two more. And one other guy also comes with his own level of confidence, and he says, you gave me one, and here it is. I did nothing with it. I made no difference with it.
And the Bible says that servant was punished.
He was punished. Why? Because he had commensurate ability, he had the gift of the master, and he did nothing with it. And that's a very sobering thought, to think that the abilities, the talents, the anointing, the skills, the experiences that I have, there's an expectation over me, and God wants that accounting day to come, and I'll be able to present some difference. Say, Lord, you put this in my life. When I went to work at Tesco, I made this difference.
Yeah.
And Lord, when I joined that upper room fellowship, I made that difference. And then you put me in that neighborhood in my life, and I made that difference. And that day I was going up to Banga on the bus, I made this difference. And when I was at that school, Lord, I made that difference. And when I was able to meet this and that person, I made that difference. And here you say, well done, you good and faithful servant. Because we made a difference with the giftings, the callings, the talents, the skills, the experiences, the grace that was upon our lives. I'm so glad he's not expecting me to account for the grace on your life. I'm so glad he's not expecting me to do what I cannot do. Otherwise, he would be an unjust God. He is a just God. He is our Father. He loves us. And you know the good news? He wants to work together with us. He's a co-worker together with us.
Amen.
And that is why Jesus says, I will not leave you as orphans, but my Spirit I will send upon you. And when He, the Spirit of truth, has come, He will help you. Another helper. He will be your standby. He will co-work together with you. He will support you. He will strengthen you. He will infuse you with divine supernatural strength so that you do not fail on your assignment. And folks, that Spirit is here. We are not waiting for Him anymore. He is here. And every day we wake up, I should drink of Him some more. The Bible says, be not drunk with the wine wherein there is dissipation, but He says, be ye being filled by the Holy Spirit. Be ye being filled every day, every opportunity we have. I told a group one time, this life you cannot live sober. If you're trying to live this life sober, you will not go. You need to be drunk. But it matters what you're drunk with. And that's why the world is trying to be drunk with something. They're trying to be intoxicated with something because you cannot face the circumstances of this life in a sober human capability and succeed. My advice choose your drink, but drink. Be drunk with the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Every day of your life. And you cannot overdose. There's no overdose in the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. The more drunk you are, the more powerful you are. But the more you drunk you are with this Northern Irish whiskey, the more useless you become. When you read that story of the talents towards the end of it, Jesus makes it even more relevant. Because he then links it to what we do in people's lives. It is about relationships. Making a difference is about relationships. And he says, some will say, but Lord, where were you when we saw you hungry and we never gave you food? Where were you sick and we never visited you? Where were you in prison and we never visited you? And he will say, if you did not do it to one of this list of the least, you did not do it unto me. And he gives us the definition of being a sheep or a goat. When you read the context of that scripture, it tells me therefore those who have the giftings, the talents, and do not use them will fall in the category of goats. I don't want to be a goat. What about you? But the other thing that I see is God, in that parable of the talent, asks us to do according to our ability. And according to our grace. So there's no room for competition. I don't have to compete with you. There is also no room for jealousy and envy.
That's right.
There's no room for comparison. I don't have to compare myself with you. Because your grace is not my grace. I just have to come alongside you and compliment you. And that's what I'm doing today. I'm bringing my supply to the giftings in the upper room.
Amen.
I can't come here and do what you do. But when God gives opportunity like this, I can bring a supply of the Spirit.
Amen.
That supply of the Spirit can complement what you do and make a difference in the Spirit and in the natural.
Amen.
You know, sometimes we get uptight and we draw back. The enemy uses it to draw back and say, you're not as good as so-and-so. You forget this thing. You just live a normal life. You know, don't try to be fanatical about this Christianity thing. Just live a normal life. You go to church on Sunday, you can sing a few songs. It's all right to speak in tongues also. That's no big deal. But you don't try to be fanatic about this thing. You know, people at work will sideline you. They'll marginalize you. They'll think you are... Don't compare yourself with so-and-so. You know, his case is a foregone conclusion. You know, he's written off. We are not to compare ourselves with each other. But we sure have to find out, what is it that God's put me here for? What is the difference for which he has called me and planted me wherever he has planted me? I don't try to be the husband that my neighbor is. But I sure must be a husband that can be emulated. A husband that people can look at and see godliness, see integrity. Must be a father that my daughters can look at and desire the God that I serve. That is my calling. Can you say amen?
Amen.
This is what making a difference requires, going the extra mile. I said being normal does not make a difference. And so we are required to go the extra mile. And if we just want to do what everybody is doing, just do the call of duty. We don't want to think outside the box. We don't want to be too extreme. We certainly don't want things that are inconveniencing. We will never make a difference. God is calling us to stretch. He is calling us to go beyond the norm. He is calling us to go beyond what everybody is doing. So everybody's doing it is not an excuse. Yeah, but that's what people do in Ireland. You're not people. You're a child of God with a specific assignment.
Amen.
I'm not coming here as a Kenyan. I know many Kenyans I would not want to be associated with. I'm coming here as an ambassador of the kingdom of heaven.
Amen.
And everywhere I step, I know who I represent.
Yes.
I represent the kingdom of my Father.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
That is very specific. that has responsibilities, but I also know it has rewards.
Yeah.
And so I would be willing to be stretched and to go the extra mile. This is what Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount. Matthew chapter 5, chapter 6, chapter 7. That Sermon on the Mount, he's not speaking to everybody. He's speaking to a very specific category of people. People that were going to extend or to expand the kingdom. You know, there are people who are happy to just come and be in a nice fellowship. But there are people that want to expand the kingdom. Those are the people Jesus is talking to. And so what he gives in chapter 5, 6, and 7 of Matthew on the Sermon on the Mount is stuff that you will not walk in if you do not want to be inconvenienced. You will not walk in them if you don't want to be radical. One of the things he tells them is this. Matthew 5, verse 38. You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist the evil man, but if anyone strikes you on the right jaw or cheek, turn to him the other one too. And if anyone wants you to sue you and take your undershirt, let him have your coat also. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him too. Wow. Now, the background of this story, some of us may know it, some of us may not. When Jesus lived the earth, it was during the time of the Roman rule. And part of the requirement from the Roman soldiers was, if a soldier was walking with his backpack, and he came and he found you or I by the roadside, he had the legal backing to be able to ask you to carry his bag for him. But the law was such that you were required to carry it for 1 mile. And so what people would do is, a soldier would come, he would find me at this point, and he would tell me, hey, Tobias, here, take. And I would take it, and be mumbling all the stuff under my breath as I wait for my 1 mile mark. And as soon as I came to the 1 mile mark, I would say, there you go, I've done my duty. And the soldier would not be expecting any different because he knew at the end of 1 mile, I finished my duty. But this is what Jesus is saying. The soldier comes and he finds me and he calls me and he says, here. And I take it and we are walking. And I come to the 1 mile mark and the soldier is expecting me to drop his backpack and he sees I keep going again. What do you think is going through his mind? He's wondering, what kind of a guy is this? What is special about this guy? Why is this guy going beyond the call of duty? Why is he doing more than what is normal? Because he's a Christian. Because he's a follower. Because he's making a difference for the kingdom. What is it that you've been called to do? Now, how much extra are you willing to do? Are we willing to go the extra mile? If we hold a job, are we willing to do more than what our contractual agreement requires? If we do business, are we willing to do more than the deal included? So that people see excellence in us? So that people see integrity in us? How much extra are we willing to do? The other thing that making a difference requires is fruitfulness. He said, be fruitful. Fruit. Remember the tree that Jesus cursed? Mm-hmm. The story is in Mark 11. Mm-hmm. You also find it in Matthew 21. Jesus looks at this tree, and this tree is green, full of leaves, looks very healthy. And surely, it must have a fruit. Surely, because it's fruit season. Jesus walks up to this tree, and the tree, as green as it is, as healthy as it is, it has no fruit. Form of godliness, denying the power. Going through the motions, but no substance. That's not the church that Jesus is calling us to. The church is calling us to is a church that has power and the demonstration of the power of the Spirit of God. The church that is calling us to is the church that has the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, gentleness, meekness, self-control. Against such there is no law. So when begin to give my long testimony, I must stop and ask myself, and the fruit? And the fruit? Because that is how I make a difference. Now, when you read that passage in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, 23, it gives you the fruit, but what comes before then is another bitter fruit also. That also makes a difference. And the works of the flesh, that also makes a difference. People will remember you. Bursts of anger. People will remember you for that. That's the guy that was so angry that anything you said, the chair could come flying at you because he was so angry.
So which fruit is that?
Fruit takes work. Fruit does not come by the laying on of hands. Fruit takes sacrifice. Fruit takes growth, and growth is stretching. When you're growing, there's something called growth pains. When you're growing out of your size, there is pain that goes with growth. And people don't want that in our day and age. We want instant coffee, instant tea. Even drive-through is delaying nowadays. No, drive-through is not that quick anymore. We want to press a button and there it is. Fruit requires us to grow. Mm. It requires us to work on things. Mm. We must be willing to work on things. We must be willing to go through the pains. So that when I feel like giving you a piece of my mind, I'm able to hold it back and say, no, I need all the pieces of my mind intact. We have to make some decisions. If we're going to make a difference, we have to make some decisions to be fruitful. We have to make some decisions that our lives would reflect. Making a difference requires us to be the light and the salt. Salt makes a difference. Light makes a difference. When light comes, darkness cannot argue. Darkness has to flee. Do you begin to realize how winning the world can be so easy if we just be came the light and the salt? There's some time we would not have to speak. Acts chapter 1 verse 8. What does Jesus say? And you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses. Mm-hmm. He did not say you shall go out and witness. He said you shall be my witnesses. Who is a witness? A witness is someone that has the ability to give proof, to show proof. So our own lives, before I open my mouth, my life has the ability to prove that Jesus is Lord. When people look at the way I live, people look at the way I conduct myself, people hear me, even in normal conversation, they say, something is different with this one. It's not the average Christian. Why? Because the Spirit of God is upon me and my life is a witness. That is what we need to pursue. That ought to be what we wake up and say, my life is going to be different today. Why? Because we are here on assignment. We are ambassadors. Kenya has a UK ambassador. The UK ambassador is in Kenya, not for the interest of Kenyans. That's not his priority. That's not why he is there. He's not there to make sure we live well. He's not there to make sure we are comfortable. He's there for the interest of the UK. He wants to see how can UK infiltrate Kenya? How can the desires of UK be achieved among the Kenyans? That's why he is there. You know why we are ambassadors here? For the interest of the kingdom of God. How can the interest of the kingdom of God be expanded in this region? That's why we are here on assignment. That's why we have special protection. You know, in the UK ambassador to Kenya has diplomatic protection. That's why we have angelic assignment, so that we can expand our assignment. But if we are not doing it, for what reason are we having that angelic protection? If the UK ambassador is not doing his duty, he'll be recalled. I'm not praying that you be recalled. But I'm asking myself, how well am I doing in my ambassadorial capacity? And so as I conclude this afternoon, I want to ask practical questions just for me, and maybe you can also ask yourself. For what I am called to do,
what am I intentionally doing to make a difference in somebody's life? And I'm using the word intentional because it does not come automatically. You do not make a difference automatically. You've got to go out of your way intentionally to say, I'm going to make a difference in somebody's life. I'm going to make a difference wherever I find myself. Mm-hmm. So what are you doing intentionally in your life to make a difference today? Something to think about. What practical things are you doing to make a difference? You know, sometimes we can be very religious in the church and say, oh yeah, we will pray. And prayer has its place, but also practical things. Practical things. What am I doing practically to make a difference in my family? Another simple question, what is it that you can add to what you are already doing to make you extraordinary? What can we add to what we are already doing? Because some of us are already doing something, but what can we add to it? Because every day is a new day for growth. And the Bible talks about moving from glory to glory to glory to glory. And sometimes, like somebody said, the greatest enemy of excellence is good. Because you're already doing good, you can rest at that station called good and never hit your target. But today God's calling us to begin to forsake certain things and begin to press on even further. So what is it that we can add? What is it that we can do to strengthen our unique difference to influence people? Because there is a uniqueness on the inside of every one of us. It needs to be anchored. It needs to be strengthened. And needs to be released so that together we can make a difference. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Folks, we are called on a divine assignment.
Yes.
Every one of us. Every one of us. Some of us are more aware of it than others. Some of us have stepped into glimpses of it. But it's time to launch in. It's time to ask yourself, what else is out there for me? Lord, this has been good, but what else is ahead for me?
Yes.
I told you earlier on, for starters, that I've been part of a ministry for 25 years, and it's been amazing and wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
What we have seen in the lives of people is amazing. But I can come there.
Mm-hmm.
But I refuse to come there.
Amen.
Because God can only get better.
Amen.
With God, things can only be more glorious.
Amen.
And so, friends, I'm excited for what lies ahead.
Amen.
Amen.
And every day I wake up, whatever it will take to stir me up to that, that is what I want.
Amen.
That's what I'm going for. That is what I'm charged for.
Yes.
Amen.
Same should be true for every one of us.
Amen.
Shall we pray?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Thank you. Shake a brand book. Oh, praise you, praise you, praise you, praise you. Hallelujah. Oh, Father, I bless you. I bless you. I bless you. This is what I would like us to do. Sometimes when we do things like this, we need to make a practical step. You know, you come to a place like this, and every one of us could think of many, many things that we could do to make a difference. But I want us to make a difference in each other's lives this afternoon. Why don't you grab somebody seated next to you, and I want you to minister to them. I want you to believe God inside your heart to just minister to them by His Spirit. If you don't know what to do, pray over them in the Spirit. If you feel led to ask them and they have a particular area of ministry that would require from you, why don't we go out and reach out to each other and just be a blessing? There is a supply of the Spirit on the inside of you that you can release over somebody this afternoon.